In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon the Prophet and his Holy Family. Laanat upon the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt. I begin with the words of the Holy Quran, Surah Taha, which is the 20th chapter, verses 25 to 28. This is the prayer that Hazrat Musa alayhis-salam recited when he began his mission. He said, O my Lord, expand my breast for me, and make my affair easy for me, and loosen the knot from my tongue, that they may understand my words. We are living in a time where vast sources of information are available to us. We have 24-hour access to Facebook, to YouTube, to Google, and all our scholars have got their own email addresses. Also, because we are living in the West, the majority of us have a large circle of non-Shia friends. It is safe to say that all of us have, at some point, had some form of discussion or debate or munazara with our non-Shia brothers. Most of us, mashallah, are quite well equipped to argue our stance based on the Sunni books. So, for example, from the Sunni books, we can discuss things such as Saqifa or Fadak or what happened at Ghadir using their own sources. However, most of us know very, very little about our own books, our own sources. So when somebody asks us about certain matters which do not appear in the Sunni books' books, then most of us do not have a clue on how to answer them. Things like the infallibility of the imams and prophets, things like Azadari, things like the Wasul, things that we can't explain from books like Sahih Bukhari. We're very poorly equipped on how to defend ourselves when we're questioned on these matters. I'm not here to prove Sunnis wrong. We all know that Shiaism is the path of the truth. What I'm more interested in is showing people, my Shia brothers and sisters, what it says in our books about the key fundamentals of our faith. There's two problems facing the Shia nation at the moment. The first is that we have external enemies, such as the Taliban, who are slaughtering us all over the world. The second problem is that we do not simply know enough about our own faith to have a key understanding of just who our imams were and what their status was. I'm not a scholar. I don't have the right to wear a turban or to sit on the minbar and give my opinions. All my rank, all my position allows me to do is to recite verses of the Quran, recite the most strongest hadith that we have, and also give the opinions of our pious scholars that have gone before us. This is a series of lectures that I will, inshallah, be doing every week. This lecture today will be discussing the infallibility of the prophets and imams. Specifically, could they sin, or could they make major or minor sins, or could they not make any sins at all? The next lecture, which I'll record after this, will be regarding whether the prophets and imams, they have firstly ilmighab. So are they in a position, even though they're in a foreign country, to hear our calls when we call them? And secondly, have they got the ability to help us? The third lecture I'll be talking about next week, inshallah, is responding to people who criticise our views. So people that say that there are examples in the Quran of prophets making mistakes, or that this is polytheism and so on. I'll be answering those in the third lecture. After that, inshallah, I'll try and get at least one lecture a week. So today's lecture is going to focus on the infallibility of the imams and the prophets and their knowledge of their unseen. In order to do this, we'll split the lecture today into two parts. The first part is to define exactly what is infallibility, what does it mean, what does it encompass. The second part of the lecture will be what isn't infallibility, at what point does our belief in infallibility become polytheism, become shirk. I'll start with discussing hadiths. There's a difference in Shia scholarship and Sunni scholarship. In Sunni scholarship, they have a series of four Sahih books. Sahih means basically infallible according to the Sunni brothers. So there are these four books which were written about approximately 100 or so years after the Prophet died, which were compiled, and our Sunni brothers believe that anybody who questions the authenticity of these books is not a Muslim. To put this into perspective, imagine if I was to write a book about Napoleon, who died in about 1820, which is about the same sort of distance between Bukhari being born and the Prophet dying. If I was to write a book of 100,000 narrations which state Napoleon did this, Napoleon did that, without giving any references how I got these statements, then there's nobody in the world that would believe what I'm saying. Unfortunately, this is almost literally exactly what the Sunnis believe. They believe that scholars such as Bukhari were given unique powers and wisdom, and able to compile hadith into a book, into whatever he believed was sahih, was reliable. The Shiaism, alhamdulillah, is a little bit more sensible. We have our own hadith, such as Bahar al-Anwar and Al-Ghafi and others. But what our scholars do is that they analyse the hadith one by one by one. So we do not have a sahih book like the Sunnis have. Our scholars, they spend their entire life studying hadith one individually and assessing each individual hadith based on its own merits. In order to do this, imagine there's a hadith that says, for example, person A heard from person B, heard from person C, that the Prophet said such and such a thing. The job of our scholars is to analyse the lives of person A, person B, person C, and see what their lives were like. Were they Muslims? Were they Shia? Were they reliable with their lives? And ask so many questions like this. This chain is called the Sanad. After our scholars have studied this chain, they next look at the content of the hadith, known as the Matan. They ask questions such as, is this similar hadith found somewhere else? Does it align with the Quran? Questions like this. Only after our scholars have studied the Sanad and the Matan did they pronounce a hadith to be strong or weak or something like that, or false, for example. One of the giants of Shia scholarship, along with people like Sheikh Sadiq, Sheikh Tusi and Sheikh Ulaini, was a man named Allama Baqir al-Majlisi. His most famous work was to compile the 110-volume encyclopedia of hadith called Bihar al-Anwar, which is the biggest set of hadiths for Shias. It's enough to say about his status that our mujtahids in this day and age spend literally their entire lives studying his works. In his own life, he made 1,000 mujtahids himself by teaching them. When you study things like his piety, his actions, his noble family, the situation in which he lived, it fills you with honour to believe that we are the same Shia as he was. So when we are discussing things like the infallibility of the Imams and the Prophets, he would be a good person to speak to, a good person to refer to whether they were infallible or not. He wrote a book called Hayat al-Qulub, which is a series of three books. The first book is the one that we'll be referring to today. In this book, he discusses things about prophethood, about the prophets before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what we're going to start off with is how Allama Majlisi himself defines infallibility. Allama states in chapter 3, "We must know that the Imamate scholars, may Allah be pleased with them, are unanimous as regards to the infallibility of the Prophet's successors and Imams. These divine personages are granted immunity from minor sins. They do not commit any sin knowingly, unknowingly, nor in forgetfulness, neither before their appointments as Prophets or Imams or afterwards, neither in childhood nor in old age. No scholar has disagreed on this." So firstly, we need to understand that this chapter is dealing solely with the infallibility of the Prophets and Imams. Our Christian brothers have this problem called a circular argument. They believe that their Bible is infallible. And when asked, why is it infallible? They say because the Bible says it's infallible. This is a circular argument, as in the Bible is infallible because the Bible says it's infallible, therefore it's infallible. So what Allama stated is that he gave four arguments based on nothing but logic why the Prophets and Imams must be infallible. It's not good enough for somebody to say to us, why do you believe that our Imams are infallible, and we can't just say because it's in our books. We need to be able to argue using logic. So Allama gave four arguments based on nothing but logic why the Prophets and Imams were infallible. The first argument that Allama states is that the Prophets are sent with a message for the people to act righteously and to abstain from evil. So the Prophets first have to practice what they preach to others. How else could their exhortations be effective? This can be illustrated by the example of some preachers and prayer leaders. In case people find them lacking in high morals and having weakness to manage detestable acts, they do not follow them. So what does this argument mean? Allama stating that the Prophets were sent with a divine message for people not to commit sins. The Prophets were not hypocrites. So for example, if there was leaders in our nation today who committed sins themselves and they told other people not to commit them, those people would not listen to that leader because he's a hypocrite. So the first argument is that we believe that our Prophets were not hypocrites. They did not tell people not to commit major or minor sins unless they themselves do not commit major or minor sins. This is the first argument. The second argument for infallibility is this. If a prophet commits a sin, a strange situation will occur. It will be necessary to obey and disobey him at the same time, because Allah the Almighty says in the Quran, "Say, if you love Allah, then follow me." This is Surah Al Imran, which is the third surah, verse 31. What does this mean? In the Quran, there are all sorts of different rules. What we can eat, what we can drink, how we give inheritance and so on to our offspring and so on. Most of the time in the Quran, there's always a condition. So for example, the Quran will say, we cannot eat the flesh of a pig unless we are starving. Or we cannot drink alcohol, for example, unless we are going to die from thirst. We cannot tell lies unless our lives are in danger and so on. There's very, very few instances in the Quran where there are no conditions. One of these situations is following the Prophet. There is nowhere in the Quran that says follow the Prophet unless he commits a sin, or follow the Prophet in such and such a situation but not in others. The Quran only says follow the Prophet in everything. So, Allama states, it is not allowed to follow a sinner in his sinful activities. So if the Quran says that follow the Prophet no matter what, and the Quran also says do not follow a sinner, if the Prophet was a sinner, then this would be a contradiction in the Quran. In order to believe that the Prophet was infallible, we must believe that the Quran is perfect. To deny that the Prophet was not infallible is to deny the Quran. This is the second argument. The third argument states, if the Prophet commits a sin, it would be incumbent to restrain him and exhort him to goodness on the basis of Amr bin Ma'ruf and Nahy al Munkar, enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. On the other hand, it is wrong to prevent a Prophet from doing anything because it is assumed that he does everything with Allah's permission. Allah says in the Quran, obey Allah and the Apostle, but if they turn back, then surely Allah does not love the unbelievers, and for this Allah has cursed such people. So what is this argument saying? This is saying that anybody who tries to stop the Prophet from doing anything that they want is not only becomes an unbeliever, but he's also cursed by Allah. So if we believe that the Prophet, if somebody witnessed the Prophet doing a sin, then what would happen was that if somebody tried to stop him, that person would be cursed by Allah, and this is an injustice. We do not believe that the Prophet, that Allah can be unjust. This is the third argument. The fourth and final argument is, from Alama, the way he states, Imam Muhammad Baqir is quoted regarding the explanation of the Quranic verse, Surah Baqarah, which is the second surah, verse 124. My covenant does not include the unjust. The Imam stated that a sin is an injustice against the person, and a fool cannot be a leader of the pious. This is an interesting hadith because it is used in explanation for the argument that certain people give that forgetfulness and being clumsy, for example, are not sins, and could the Imams do them? The Imam said that a fool cannot be a leader of the pious. Things like being clumsy and forgetful are counted as foolish acts. Next, I'd like to talk about a hadith from Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam, which is on page 20 of the same book. In an authentic hadith, Mufaddal asked Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam how he, the Imam, was aware of all that happened in every nook and corner of the earth while he remained at home with a curtain across his door. Imam said, O Mufaddal, the Almighty Allah has granted five spirits to the prophets. Before I carry on, I want to talk a little bit about what this hadith is about to say. About 100 years ago, there was a philosopher called Sigmund Freud, and he believed that our consciousness is split into three parts. There's the ego, the superego, and the id. And these three parts have different characteristics, but together they form who we are. What the Imam said is that we have four different parts. Now, in this hadith, these parts are called spirits. And when I say spirit, don't think of it as though I'm talking about a ghost or something like that. I'm talking about a part of the consciousness. The Imam explains that there's four parts of our consciousness, and the fifth that is unique to the Masums. So the Imam said, O Mufaddal, the Almighty Allah has granted five spirits to prophets. Firstly, the spirit of life. He moves and walks with the spirit. This is the lowest level of consciousness. His basic being awake and looking around and sensing things. Secondly, the spirit of the hearts. He rises with it and does jihad. So above that is the part which has the innate ability for us to know what is right and what is wrong. Thirdly, the spirit of shuhur. He eats and drinks by it. So this is our urges, our hunger, our thirst, our sleepiness, and so on. Fourthly, the spirit of faith, by which he has faith and deals justly with the people. So above this is our religion, our spirituality, our belief in Allah. Fifthly and finally, the Holy Spirit, by which he bears the position of prophethood. When the Prophet departs from this world, the Holy Spirit comes to the Imam, who succeeds him. This spirit is not concerned with sleep, carelessness, useful pastimes or pride. The other four spirits are sometimes prone to sleep and inattentiveness. They are involved in vain pursuits and have pride also. Prophets and Imams see through the Holy Spirit and know about different affairs. So what does this mean? We believe that Hazrat Adam alayhi salam was the first prophet. We also believe that every single prophet in history has always appointed a leader before he died. Now what this hadith is saying is that all the experiences, all the spiritual power, all the wisdom of the prophet beforehand is passed to his successor before he dies. So that successor, he gains all that knowledge and all that wisdom and all that power, and he adds his own experiences, his own knowledge. And when it comes for him to choose his successor, that is passed on to the next one, and so on and so on and so on down the line. So starting from Hazrat Adam alayhi salam until the awaited Imam, Imam Mahdi alayhi salam. Imam Mahdi alayhi salam is the repository of all the knowledge, all the wisdom, all the spiritual power of all the prophets and all the Imams that have ever come from Hazrat Adam alayhi salam. And through this spiritual power, he is aware of all the things that are happening literally in every nook and corner of the earth. This is our belief in our Aqidah. Leaving Hadith for the time being, let's look at what a more contemporary scholar says. Ayatollah Khomeini says in his book, Al-Hukum Al-Islamiyah, on page 52, he states, "Certainly the Imam has a dignified station, a lofty rank, a creational caliphate, and sovereignty and mastery over all atoms of the universe." There's no discussion here, there's no debate, there's no difference of opinion. This is the absolute fundamental of our faith, of our Shia faith. Next lecture that I do, inshallah, I'll go into this in more detail. So we've discussed what is infallibility. It is absolutely impossible for any prophet or any imam to commit a sin. We believe that in the same way that the prophets are masoom, the same way that the imams are masoom too, they cannot commit any sin. Next, we need to look at what is the difference between our belief in infallibility and what is shirk. Shirk is believing that the imams have any power that is unique to them, which is independent from Allah. We believe that every single thing that the imams do is by Allah's permission. They do nothing without his permission. To believe that Allah has delegated all responsibility to running the universe to the imams and somehow retreated, this isn't true either. We always believe that Allah is the ultimate power. Through him, all things happen. Finally, and I'll leave you with this for today, that to believe that the prophets and imams were sent to guide us and help us and listen to us, and Allah's given them the tools to help us, is to understand that Allah is indeed just and wise and has a plan for us all. So,